driving for the first time a realistic representation of an hybrid Formula One car was a shock. The workload on the driver is really high. Driving the car on the limit is already quite demanding, but with all the additional stuff you have to handle, it all seems like too much at first. Once you get familiar with all the controls and what they do, it gets a bit easier. So, why creating this video? There are dozens of guides for this car out there after all. The reason is I feel these guides focus on theory too much. As an example, they all explain with great detail the energy delivery map's behavior, but they don't give the driver tips on how and when to use them. It is true that you need to understand the theory first, so unfortunately, that is where we have to start. In this first part of the guide, we'll learn about the different controls and the individual settings inside them. That will allow me to do what I want in the next chapters, and that is to give you examples of good use of all these settings in different situations. Let's go for it! This car recovers energy from two different systems. Thermal energy is recovered by the MGUH, and kinetic energy is recovered through the MGUK. The kinetic energy recovery happens under braking, and it is the biggest source of energy by a big margin, even if it is limited by the regulations. The thermal energy recovery happens typically when the turbo is working at full boost under acceleration. The amount of energy recovered this way is lower in this car, but it is not limited by the regulations, so in the real cars, this is a very important area for car development. Let's start talking about the MGUH controls. These are fairly simple. This control only has two positions, motor and battery. In motor mode, the energy recovered is deployed without delay. In battery mode, the energy recovered is stored to increase the battery charge and to be deployed later. Motor mode is generally used in qualifying laps or in parts of the race where it is critical to go fast. It is also useful for race starts or any moment of the race where the battery happens to be full. Battery mode is often used in long runs and gives the driver more energy to play with when he feels it is needed. Now, let's talk about MGUK recovery controls. These are fairly easy to understand too. When you push this button, you cycle a percentage that goes from 0 to 100%. This is the amount of energy you want to recover during the braking zones. High energy recovery will benefit you in long runs, giving you more power to play with. Low energy recovery will give you better braking performance. Now, let's compare the energy both systems can recover. We will use this battery charge as reference. Now, I'll drive one lap where kinetic energy is not recovered, only thermal energy goes to the battery, with the MGUH in battery mode. No energy will be deployed in this lap. This is the battery one lap later, but let's do one more lap. And you can see the result is still the same. We got like a 15% gain on battery every lap. Now, we will try the opposite. We will only recover kinetic energy, and we will set the car to deploy immediately all the thermal energy so it doesn't interfere. I'll set the MGUK recovery to maximum. Let's drive like this for a while, you just keep an eye on the battery bar. In just one braking zone, we recovered like 15% of the bar, same as we did before in one full lap. Let's keep an eye on the battery because there's another big stop coming. In just two braking zones, we took the bar from half to almost full. We can see the huge gains of a high setting for the MGUK recovery. So why not having it always at maximum? This will be our next topic. We've seen the pros, let's see the cons now. Right before the hybrid era, Formula 1 cars had a typical brake distribution of around 60-40. We can see this value as default in both the Ferrari F138 and the Lotus Exos. However, kinetic energy recovery interferes with this distribution. Now, we load the default setup on the SF-15 hybrid car, and you can see the default is quite different. In a car with the MGUK recovering energy in the braking zones, the stopping distances get longer. You lose stopping power, and also the bias you select for the brakes doesn't apply. The MGUK is interfering with that balance. So, if you want the full braking performance of the car and the natural brake feel of a non-hybrid car, you have to disable the MGUK recovery. This is typically done in qualifying laps, when you start with a full battery and you know the energy will last for the full effort. You set a natural brake bias, disable the energy recovery and get a car that stops better, and where the brake bias you select is exactly what you will get. If you want the best performance of the car over one lap, you have to disable the energy recovery, or set it to the lowest possible value that will allow you to complete a lap without running out of energy. Of course, you cannot afford to do this over a race distance. You need to recover energy to keep your pace up for more than one lap, so you have to cope with the MGUK messing up your brake distribution. There is one last control we haven't talked about yet, and its mission is to compensate for the negative effect of the MGUK recovery when you brake. This control is called engine brake. Let's see how it works. Every time you push the button, you cycle a value that goes from 1 to 13. This controls the amount of engine braking you get from the combustion engine of the car. A high energy recovery value will have a similar effect to a lot of engine braking in a classic non-hybrid car. So when you use a high recovery value, you want low engine braking from the combustion engine to avoid rear locking. On the other hand, when you run low energy recovery values and only the brakes are slowing the car, you want a higher value for the engine braking coming from the combustion engine. Less engine brake increases rear stability when the recovery system is working hard. More engine brake gives you a more classic braking feel when you disable the energy recovery. Use low values in race conditions, when you need high energy recovery. Use high values in qualifying, when you can get away with low energy recovery values. Of course, remember you can also change the brake bias of the car at all times, to change the way the car behaves into the corners. That was all about the energy recovery settings. We change topic now and we will start talking about the energy delivery, or how all this stored energy is used. The energy delivery is controlled by presets that the driver can change. They all respect some basic principles you should understand first. Energy is best used at medium speeds. At low speeds, deploying energy is useless, as the tires cannot put it down. You will just increase wheel spin and waste energy. Once the car is not traction limited, it's time to use energy to increase acceleration. The energy you deploy in the early part of the straights keeps benefiting you all the way to the next braking zone. When the car gets up to high speeds, energy use is not useless, but the gains get smaller and smaller. You are about to brake anyway, so energy use is less efficient. Now, let's go through the delivery modes individually and explain the difference between them. We'll start with the charging mode. In this mode, there's not energy delivery at all. The battery only charges. It is used in qualifying to get the car ready for a hot lap, or in the race in very special circumstances. Like if you want to prepare an attack on a slower car and you are low on energy. Keep charging mode all the way to the start of a hot lap in qualifying, and avoid it on race day if the battery is already full. That's a waste. This is fairly easy to understand. Next, the two most useful modes, balance low and balance high. These are optimized following the ideas I explained before. They don't deliver at low speeds, then they deliver a lot of energy once the car is not traction limited, and then they reduce the energy use as speed goes up. Eventually, they stop energy delivery at very high speeds. The difference between them is the amount of energy deployed. We'll do a straight comparison now to understand the difference between these two modes better. We will drive two laps at Barcelona with energy recovery at 70%, one lap with balance low and one lap with balance high, and see how that affects the battery levels. This is the battery level after a slow outlap in balanced low mode, with 70% recovery. Now, we will keep these settings and drive one more lap. Then, we'll check the charge we have. You can see that the battery still has pretty much the same level. This mode is very good to keep stable energy levels and steady lap times over long runs. Now, we set balanced high mode and drive another lap. We have lost around 15% charge over one lap, but we have gone 7 times faster than before. This mode is not as sustainable, but it provides a good pace boost that you can keep for several laps without the battery going critical. Now let's talk about top speed mode. This is a race mode for tracks with many long straights. I'll explain how it works with text. This is how one of the balance modes will deploy energy. This logic works well for most tracks, but if there are several high-speed sections, the car will hit a wall when the delivery stops. Top speed mode will do this instead. Just two more modes to go now. Overtake mode is supposed to help you pass slower cars. It is similar to the balance modes. It gives you very high energy at medium speeds, but this one doesn't cut deployment at high speeds. It will keep doing this every straight, so it will empty your battery quite fast. If you cannot make a move in a couple of laps, you will have to recover energy for a while in another mode. I am not a huge fan of this mode. I prefer to stay in the balance modes and use the boost button if I see an opportunity open. We'll talk about that button soon. This mode gives you a lot of energy for every straight, so the good thing is that you will be ready to punish any mistakes from your rival without the need to be pushing buttons at all. The last mode is called Hot Lap, and it's used for qualifying laps. It delivers a lot of energy at every range of speeds, but it will still deliver more energy at medium speeds. It doesn't deliver maximum power all the time for two reasons. One, it will hard drive ability a lot on the exit of slow corners, and two, the battery will be empty before the end of one lap. This mode pays special attention to drive ability, and your throttle position is an important factor in the amount of energy you will get. There's a boost button ready to deploy this mode at any time for as long as you hold it. It is the same button that deploys cars in other cars. And that was it. In the next video about this topic, I'll show some textbook examples on how to handle all these settings. Now we know what every button does, it's time to learn how to use them in every situation. Thanks for watching.